Sculptor E.B Cox is in his 80s. His eyes are beginning to weaken, but that doesn't stop him from starting work in his backyard studio every morning at 7. That's because E.B. Cox is a doer. Alfred Bradley is E.B. to his friends, a man who's been quietly creating works in his own style for more than 5 decades. E.B. has more sculptures on public view in Toronto than any other artist. A new book called E.B. Cox, A Life Sculptor, celebrates his work. We visited him early one morning.
I'm a sculptor because that's what I think of doing, and I get out there every day and do something with it. I'm not interested in fame because it doesn't mean a thing. If they want to make me famous right now and buy my stuff at thousands of dollars, I don't know what I'd do with the money. Anyway, I'm not interested in it. I'm interested only in working while I still can.
As opposed to the troubled, tortured, brooding artiste, he is a childlike person, and I don't mean childish. I mean childlike in the sense that he shares with a child that innocence of vision, where it gives him such pleasure, I think, in seeing the possible body or face that is locked in a piece of mineral, a piece of quartz, a piece of stone, a piece of wood, and the delight he takes in helping this form come into being, you know, by carving and polishing.
I could whittle, and I was allowed to whittle. The best thing of it is I was allowed to make chips in the house and whittle, and I was never considered bad for doing that. If my father had company, they would say, "Oh, what a nice thing. Oh, that's nice. That was nice. Did you do that? Oh, I'd like that." And I'd give it to them until I wised up to the fact that they never gave me anything in return. I wanted to do a head, a face. I've done dozens of faces, dozens of them, but they're not as good as that. I won't sell it to anybody. I've been offered cash money for it, but I can't part with it. I have to keep it. I just did things, and I tried to sell them, and tried to be pleasant, and tried to accommodate what people liked. Oh, I've done everything. Well, to satisfy myself, I have to do that first of all, which I've never quite succeeded. But I have to do things that are attractive and nicely shaped. I thought, well, I didn't have to worry at all. I can just make these little things now and then when I get time and sell them to people. But actually, it wasn't so easy to sell to people. You had to be satisfied with $5 or $4 or something. Nowadays, it seems ridiculous. But for $4, you could live comfortably. You could eat for a week with that money. That's pre-war stuff.
He was just our father, you know. He did his work. We didn't question it. That's what he did. And I remember always waking up in the morning to the sound of the air compressor, Dad at work.
Yeah.
And it's still a sound that makes me feel good.
Our friends' dads always went off to the office, whereas our dad went out to the studio, and it was always a little bit dusty, a little bit of stone dust on him all the time.
He's sort of the Mark Twain of contemporary art, you know. He's a salty character, and he does what he wants, and he's totally independent, you know. He doesn't care what people think. I think he wants people to like his work, but if they don't, that's their problem, you know, and he goes about doing what he does.
You make beautiful things because you have to, because you think of them, and you have the material, and so you just do it. And you say, and people come in, "Oh, I admire that. How much do you charge for that?" I say, "Well, I'm not too anxious to sell it." And that's the sure thing. If you're not too anxious to sell it, then they want it. This is a reclining figure, but I'm not satisfied with the thing. I have never completed. There's no face on it. It's not satisfactory. That's why it's still here. If it was satisfactory, somebody would try to buy it probably, and I wouldn't have it at all.
E.B. Cox is a paradox. He's both central and peripheral to it, and I'll explain what I mean. He's central to the Canadian art tradition in the historical sense that he was highly influenced by people like the Group of Seven and was a good friend with people like Barker Fairley, who was a good friend of the Group of Seven. So there's a direct lineage from the group down through E.B., and in a sense, he's the last of his breed. So historically speaking, you could argue that he's part of the mainstream. But in terms of his appearance in galleries, his national fame, he's not. He's a peripheral figure. He's almost a solitary, reclusive, mysterious figure who works away on his own.
I was amazed that they just talked ordinary, but they could do marvelous paintings and stuff like that. And the year I graduated from university, I went on a canoe trip with Barker Fairley and A.Y. Jackson. I thought they were wonderful. I remember sitting with A.Y. and he would dab the paint on and with a old, dirty old brush and whack it on and sing all the time. He was a marvelous fellow. And it wouldn't look as if it was ever going to be a painting with all the putting on everywhere. And it turned out to be, had the spirit of the things. And I learned from him that you don't try to be exact. You try to get the feeling and the mood of things. You just let it happen.
Now, what time were you up here this morning?
Well, as soon as the sun's up, really. I like what's shaded here, but I like the light for my work. If it's too dull of a day or cloudy or something, I don't work quite so early. Even as I did this morning. I found you came too early and I was a bit annoyed at you. I thought I had another hour.
Don't want to interfere with work. Work comes first. He works in the morning, come rain or shine. He always gets up early. Yes.
It's a piece that I did a long time ago, but I'm reshaping it, making a nice torso out of it. It's walnut and it'll be nice when it's done, but it's not much to look at right now. But I think I'll be able to make something nice out of it. But I don't have much walnut to work with, big chunks. Nowadays they don't make them so big. And well, I use what I can. And I don't do much wood, it's usually stone that I work. I use the air compressor pretty nearly everything nowadays. I've given all my hand tools away to beginning sculptors, and you start with hand tools, of course. You can do exactly what you want, but it takes longer. And I'm tired of taking a long time at doing things. I like to work quickly. Hammer and chisel is too slow. I'm not Michelangelo, you know. I don't know how he did it. He was a genius beyond compare. I was asked by the Georgian Peaks people to do some sculpture and put it up on the hill for Georgian Peaks. And I ended up by doing 21 or 2 pieces of quite big things in limestone. By that time, I was capable of working all day with the power tools. I'm not a very strong person, but I was a little bit better then. It was 40 years ago, and I would work all day and carve the things. And as soon as one was done, I would do another.
When he does this, sort of huge constructions in public have to be carved with chainsaws and mechanical saws, and so I think he tends to lose touch with the work. I don't mean that it fails, I just mean that it loses intimacy. I think E.B. is essentially a miniaturist, by which I do not mean that his work is it's small and insignificant. I mean, I think he's at his best when he can sort of get his hands on an entire block of stone or an entire piece of wood, you know. I have a little piece of E.B. Cox's here that he gave me. It's a little beautiful little pink granite. Is it granite? Is it marble? My ignorance is showing. It's a pink stone that has a semi-translucent quality. It's a torso, beautifully sinuous torso. It's very crude in a sense, but it's also very endearing. I can put it in my pocket, you know. And it has all the nobility of a beautiful, primitive, perhaps Greek, or maybe earlier sculpture.
There's a piece of alabaster. It looks terrible right now, but I know that if I make a figure out of that, I can make a woman with head up here and the buttocks out there and nicely shaped, and oh he can make it lovely. And if I hollow it out from the other side, it'll be translucent and the light will, it'll be a dark pink, and it looks, well, it's the figure, human, it's the human being. Human beings are the only thing really worth trouble. I sometimes have two or three things working, not many more. I just keep busy until I get hungry, and then I come in and, well, it's 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, and I says, well, I think I'll take the afternoon off. But nowadays I take the afternoon off because I'm a senior citizen.
When do you usually pack it in for the winter?
When it gets too cold. I've got a coat on now, but well, I'll work until, well, it just depends on the weather. Sometimes it's December before I have to quit.
Oh, there's no way we could stop him. There's no way he's going to stop sculpting. If he could be, he could be stone blind. Now he can see fairly well, and his eyesight isn't deteriorating anymore, from what we understand. I'm concerned that he's not able to enjoy life quite as well as he once did. But as long as he's able to work, that's what he wants to do. Never dream of encouraging him to stop doing that.
I just do what I can. And if it's messy and sloppy, I say that's the way it is. And I'm not going to give it up until I drop dead. So there.
I think he'll be remembered as this sort of two-fisted, tough little leprechaun who always, for 80 years, did more or less what he wanted. And you know how many of us can say that?